Hello, and welcome back. In this video, I would like to walk you through the process and the workflow I followed to model this V8 engine crankcase in Blender without any blueprint or technical drawing, while still attempting to maintain an acceptable level of accuracy, but also a reasonable amount of sanity. So, if this sounds like your kind of fun, grab your favorite drink, sit comfortably, and let's get started. One of the most common reactions I get from people when I show them this project is basically one question: why Blender? Why not using CAD for this kind of mechanical modeling? And they have a point. This is a perfectly legitimate question. Well, I do know CAD. I'm a mechanical draftsman by trade, and my daily weapon of choice is Creo Parametric by PDC. I'm also quite decent with SolidWorks and Inventor and a few others. So these are all great softwares for engineering and precise mechanical designing. Blender to me is more like a legitimate art medium. And since I'm doing this with animation and rendering in mind, I believe that this is the most balanced choice, because even if modeling will be trickier, and by the way, I love a challenge, I will definitely have an advantage when it will come to lighting, texturing, rigging, and animating my project, which, by the way, involves not only this crankcase, but the whole Ferrari F40 engine. I know this is crazy, I know it doesn't make much sense, but it's fun, and keeping everything fun is what makes you push through things. My goal is to reproduce an acceptable approximation of some of the most complex and precise geometries in mechanical engineering. My problem is that I don't have access to the enormous amount of data that I'd need to do that. These are well-kept industrial secrets, so finding blueprints is out of question. Well, the good news is the internet is full of pictures. You just have to find them. This is the PureRef file I've put together in the last months. It contains every possible picture of the engine that I've found along the way. And I know it's a bit messy, I'm really struggling to find the right balance in keeping it organized while constantly updating it, so please forgive the mess. And I must say, I'm pretty happy on how it's coming along. I love this thing. This thing is my best friend in this journey. To put everything in perspective, if I say that I spend more time here looking at these pictures than actually modeling in Blender, I'm not exaggerating. This is how important it is. Anyway, one great source of information are online spare parts suppliers. They often have exploded diagrams and dimensional data, especially about screws, nuts, and other small parts. Okay, back in Blender. This is the part almost done. Just need some final touches, but we're basically there. So let's talk about how I did this. To me, the most reasonable way to do something like this, given the starting conditions that I mentioned, was to think this project as what the real counterpart actually is. A system. A system built of many parts that work together and therefore are dimensionally interconnected. And since we are talking about an obscene amount of different geometries, we have to start from the obvious ones at our disposal, the cylinders. The cylinders are the simplest but also the wisest choice when it comes to where to start, because they are made by the only two dependable figures that we can easily find, the bore and a stroke, which basically are a diameter and a height. And this is exactly what I started from, a diameter and a height. With these two simple figures, I already have a ton of information, because I now have the combustion chamber. And so, That means that I can also model the piston. So I use the bore diameter as a starting point to dimension the piston with the help of my photo reference. With that and some website scavenging, I can consequently ballpark derive the connection rod and work my way up to the rest of the parts. This is what I finally came up with. As far as modeling is concerned, I try to keep the geometry the simplest I could. It's pretty clear that this in no way is a low poly project, but this doesn't mean that I won't do everything I can to keep the overall count constantly checked where possible. This is why instancing helps a lot in this. Any repeated part is a perfect candidate to be instanced, since its geometry is not actually added to the overall count. So, having for example 8 instances instead of copies of any complete piston, connecting rod or every other small bit saves a lot of geometry and general weight to the scene. Anyway, another great asset we can derive from the stroke value is the circumference of the center point of the connecting rods. This is a clear example of what I was talking about in the introduction, how each part contains the information to model the next one. So now you see how, combining this new bit of information with our current progress, we now have enough reference points to get fairly close at the actual geometry of the crankshaft. At this point, we already have a great deal of information about the whereabouts of, let's call them, points of interest. The crankshaft marks the position of all the bearings, and therefore of all the caps. And the stroke gives us not just another one, but two more great information: the spot of both the bottom and the top dead centers. Before we know, we have gathered enough intelligence to finally attempt the real challenge, the mighty crank haze. This is where I started from. This planar surface here, because it was the obvious choice, since it was easier, since the planarity, it was easier to start from here. And also because I had the circles precisely already positioned. This is actually, I mean, of the whole geometry, the best starting point possible, easier to start from. I tried to gauge what this rectangle dimension could have been, also using my photo reference. I tried to get the right proportions from these pictures, and at the same time I also found the dimension of these studs here. So being able to know this dimension and know these dimensions quickly helped me to, you know, figure out what the real proportion of this whole piece, give or take, are. So there we are, there we go. And then from here, I knew that I just have to extrude my way down here to match the geometry of the engine. And I had a great reference of that as well. Not perfectly orthogonal, but it was a start. So we knew this shape goes pretty much straight until here, then bends towards an ideal horizontal line, and then meets the cylinders. So you have this interesting shape here, and this is the first tricky spot actually of the model. So I had to figure out a module or a pattern, even if it was not easy, because as you see, all these bits are what made this engine quite different, each part from the other. But I tried to maintain a sense of regularity as much as was possible. So you can see from the side as well. And while I was doing this, you see that I was already trying to maintain the most regular edge flow possible, the most regular topology, but I already knew that I had to face this side here, the front side, which is pretty articulate, and also the rear one, which is, let me hide this thing here, or just let's isolate the crankcase. So you see that each side is actually different from the other. And that required a lot of improvisation, actually, because you can't just be too rigid about topology in certain cases if you want to get somewhere. You have to make some adjustments along the way, but that's basically, oops, this one shouldn't be here. Let's fix that. Okay, save it. As you can see, you always are retouching things. It's never finished. But anyway, yeah. So this is how it went, basically. The priority was to do the sides first, to give the right proportions, and then from there complete this part, also using the reference I already had. So I knew that this geometry was here, so I knew that this was the cap. You use this shape to basically model its negative on the other side. So if you hide this, you see that this fits. Not only this fits, but the cap actually helped model this part here and was a great reference to have, as you can see. This was possible basically just doing all the tiny steps that was required to reach this point. And this is why it's so important to have a defined plane of action before tackling something like this. And so, to make a quick recap of what I showed you so far. This was a first look at the project that started very randomly around the fantasy that every true car enthusiast has had in her or his life. Building an engine piece after piece, watching it come to life, and enjoying every minute of it. Well, the point of this video is to testify that I'm actually living something that's really close to that experience. And while I'm perfectly aware of the vastity of this project, and even if I know that the learning curve of all of this will be scaringly steep, the process has become so fun and rewarding that I just want to go on and enjoy the ride. And by the way, if you enjoyed the video and want to see where the story goes, you may consider to subscribe and follow my little tiny channel. It would be great to share this with you, to read your comments and learn from your much appreciated feedback. So, thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.